It's Fran. I'm at the bench again. And I came upon something very interesting that I wanted to take apart. I actually went out and got one of these. It's new old stock. I don't know when it was made. But it's an analog electromechanical accurate frequency meter. Let me show that there. I don't know when this was made, but I mean, it looks like it was made in the 50s or the 40s. It's got this black phenolic sort of, you know, Bakelite case. You can kind of see the little sort of Bakelite look to it. The patina on the brass parts looks pretty thick, you know, but it's new. It's never been installed. It came in the mummy wrap and all that stuff, and I'm very intrigued. When I found out that a seller had one of these, I was sitting there. I must have spent a whole evening just sitting there wondering how you can make a completely electromechanical line frequency meter. Let's take a look at it close up. Okay, here we go. Here's the meter close up. It's a JBT frequency meter, patented, it says, made by JBT Instruments Inc. in New Haven, Connecticut, USA, and operates, it says, 100 to 130 volts, and it issues the frequency of the line current from 56 to 74 hertz. And this is like one of the things that I just really wanted to investigate. There's that Bakelite case. It's got some, you know, inked markings on it. 44, 29, 31. Yeah, it's probably some kind of internal number. This size, it says 6625-00 and 993-3466. And those are actually coated over. You can see there, it's got a clear coat over top of that so that those didn't wash off. Yeah, those are numbers, and it's not heavy, and I, like I said, I was really busting my brain trying to figure out, without Googling it, mind you, how something like this could work, and it was really perplexing. I churned my brain for some time on it. I don't think this is actually hermetically sealed or filled with gas or anything, because it doesn't seem to me like any like seals. These have been gliptoled. These two bolts here have been gliptoled over. So I guess that's mounting, that the whole assembly is mounted there. But I think if I take these three side screws off, I should just be able to pull the whole assembly right out the back. Oh, yep. Machine screws. No self-tapping nonsense, and I see a proper brass bushing in there, so this is spare no expense. Everything done right. Yep. Little machine screws. Oh yeah, okay. Alright, so. Yep. I feel like that scene where in, was it For Your Eyes Only, where James Bond has to pull the detonator out of the nuclear warhead, and it's like vibrating and you know the scene I'm talking about. Oh, look at that. Oh, okay. Spare no expense. Look at that. Now that is something. And right away, it begins to show the principles involved here. We got a coil of wire and two plates here that are at an angle, and they're also sort of angled away, so these two plates here, they are sort of spaced so that their gap is further apart between them on the low end of the scale, and they're closer together on the high end of the scale. We got a really good thick coil of magnet wire, about the size of a single coil guitar pickup, just about exactly the same size as a single coil guitar pickup, and about as many windings on there too. And we got a really heavy brass bass on the back there. Really heavy. It looks like that's probably for dampening, which I'll show in a moment why that would be necessary. And the display itself, you can see that these are actually, it's actually an assembly of metal springs, steel springs, that I guess you would call tines, because they're sort of like the tines that are in a thumb harp, you know, where you pluck the little things and they go doom doom doom. And apparently the magic of this really has to do with the harmonic resonance of each of these tines. So just holding it up here, maybe it's visible, maybe it's not visible, but each of these little tines is slightly different in mass. I don't know if they would do it with different thicknesses or different widths or if they're hand-tuned, but they're all attached in the back behind the coil here on this heavy brass mount. You can see the end of it there. It's a big heavy brass mount.
Yeah.
You can see it back way, way, way down in there. Maybe you can see the, oh, there you go. See the mounting points down in there? And each of these little metal springs, I get to get the microphone really close, has a different resonant frequency. I'm going to get the microphone down here. Is that picking up? And then on the high end, again. So each of these individual little steel springs has a different harmonic resonance. And when the line voltage is applied to the coil, the alternating current causes a magnetic field which alters in poles from north to south at the rate of the line frequency, so that it will, you know, cycle up and down once every, you know, cycle of, you know, so if it's 60 hertz, as the polarity of the coil and the magnetic field goes back and forth, it's pulling on these tines up and down all equally. But the one that has the harmonic resonance that is closest to the actual frequency will vibrate the most. So let's power this up and see how it works in real life. Right. First thing I do is get the static resistance, the coil, 16 kilo ohms, so 16K. So it's designed to pull very little current. So at 120 volts, it's gonna be, yeah, 7 milliamps, 7.5 milliamps. So yeah, hardly anything at all, which, you know, you would expect for something that would be designed to be on all the time, probably in circuit. So I got my variac out, and I'm gonna right. Oh, that, well, that's a perfect stand. Double uses, all right. Yeah, I'm gonna start with the variac all the way down. Apply voltage, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100 volts. All right, 110. Zoom in here. All right. You can see that right there at 60 hertz. That one is vibrating I'll go up to 120 volts, because it actually will go up to 130 volts, so I'm just going to push it a little bit. All right, there you go. There's the resonant frequency, 60 hertz. Now, some people might say, Fran, why don't you hook this up to a circuit and you can vary the frequency? Well, actually, I spent a lot of time thinking about how I could do that on the cheap. But, you know, we talk about mains voltages. It's not so straightforward to have, you know, like a variable frequency. They do make variable frequency drivers, which I actually looked into getting one for this experiment, but I couldn't get a deal on a used one cheap. They're actually pretty expensive. They're used for driving, you know, motors, you know, three-phase motors and such, where they vary the frequency, and you can get them that are programmable and stuff and everything. But it turned out to be not worth it. I thought too about, you know, building some kind of a power transistor thing with a signal generator and everything. But then when I thought about the preamplifiers and everything for the drivers for the power transistor and all that, and then isolating things so I didn't blow up the auto generator and everything, I thought it just wouldn't be worth it just to watch this actually change. But yeah, if you, you know, but I'm amazed just how accurate that is. There's really no response at all from the 59 hertz and the 61 hertz times. It is accurate to the cycle. All right. The spooky action of analog electromechanical frequency counters. Wow. A piece of artwork. It's really just a precision crafted piece of art. It really is. Just beautiful. Working out on the bench in the lab. Yeah. Well, that's it for this one. Thanks for watching. Thanks to all of those great people down on the Patreon making all these videos possible. It's true. It's the reason I'm able to do this and keep the ads at a minimum and everything. They keep the lights on and get the toys, you know, flowing to the Fran Lab so that I can direct them to you. All right, if you like this video or any video, if you want to become a patron, just follow the link in the description. All right. I'm Fran. I'll be back here in the lab at the bench real soon. Bye! In the lab. That's where I work. Berserk in my lab. It's where I work. Watching Fran Lab. It's what I'm doing. Working at the bench.